Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Marco Rubio, United States Senator from Florida.
Thank you. First of all, thank you guys for having me and for this opportunity to talk to you about this important topic. I just have a few minutes with you today, so I thought I'd share with you my thoughts on this issue of upward mobility, empowerment, and opportunity in the 21st century. The thing I always talk about when I get into politics, the thing that I view everything I do through the lens of, is my own personal experience. And some of you may be familiar with it by now, but my parents were working class folks. They immigrated to the United States, and my dad was basically a bartender. My mom worked all kinds of jobs. She was a stock clerk at Kmart, a cashier at hotels, a maid at a casino in Las Vegas, where we lived for a period of time. But what defined their lives was wanting the opportunity to give us a chance to do all the things they never had a chance to do. That was really the purpose and meaning of their life. You know, for a lot of different reasons outside of their own control, they were not able to be who they wanted to be. I think some of us need to stop and realize our parents were once our age. And when they were our age, they had hopes for themselves as well. There were things they wanted to do with their life. And sometimes they did that. But sometimes, through no fault of their own, it became impossible. And so the purpose of their life was to give us the chance to do all the things they never had a chance to do. Now, that's my story, but it's just not a unique story. That's probably your story, or so many of your story, whether it's the story you're living right now, or it's the story of your grandparents, your great-grandparents, your parents, or yourself. The thing that's defined us as a nation and as a people, perhaps more than anything else, is that we have been that place where it didn't really matter where you came from, or at least we've always said that that's who we want to be. And the American story, as much as anything else, has been that continuous struggle to ensure that we are that place where it doesn't matter where you're born, or who you're born to, or how your last name is pronounced, or how poor your parents were, or what they did for a living. You shouldn't be limited by any of that. That we've always said that we believe that if you have a good idea and you have talent, you should be able to go as far as your hard work and your talent will take you. That's come to define our culture and our society. We all say that. So the question for policymakers like myself is, what is our job in regards to that, other than just to talk about it? Other than just to constantly brag about the fact that that's who we've been and that's who we want to continue to be, what can we do about it? What can government do, and what is the role of policymakers in making that possible? And I think in the year and a half that I've been thinking about this, I've come to the conclusion that this really is the central issue that we're debating. That virtually every other issue we're talking about, whether it's government spending or the role and size of government or tax policy or regulatory policy or energy policy, all these economic issues are directly linked to the central goal of ensuring that we are a place where people can do better than their parents did, and where people can do better than they once were. That, in essence, those who are in poverty can pull themselves into the middle class. Those who are in the middle class can maintain themselves there or reach even higher. And we don't have to do that at the expense of people who have already made it. That, in essence, we can grow our economy and therefore grow opportunities so that instead of being a zero-sum game, we can all benefit without having to take away from anybody else. And I hope that that's what guides our policy debates in the new Congress. Now look, I'll be perfectly blunt with you, because I don't want to waste your time into believing that somehow in the weeks that are left before the next election, this Congress is all of a sudden going to get active and start passing a bunch of stuff that's going to be helpful. But I do think, irrespective of how the elections turn out this November, in January, I hope we'll get a fresh start on this issue, and that we'll be focused like a laser on making sure that this increasingly becomes a nation where people can leave their children better off than themselves, and where they can accomplish their own hopes and dreams, and that every issue we take on is viewed through that lens. I hope that that's what the debate will become about. Now, there's two things at play here that I think have to be balanced. And let me start by saying I fully acknowledge that my dad was a bartender, my mom was a stock clerk at Kmart. But I understand that in the 21st century, in the year 2012, a bartender and a stock clerk cannot give their children the opportunities that a bartender and a stock clerk were able to give us two decades ago. The world is just a different place. In many ways, the world has an opportunity to be a much better place. But we have to recognize that reality. And so our dual goals need to be, on the one hand, we need an economy that's vibrant and growing, an economy that's creating opportunities not just for jobs, but for businesses, an economy that has both the consumer buying power, but also the conditions necessary for people to go out and open a business out of the spare bedroom of their home and have it succeed. For people to be able to go out and find a job in the field that they studied for. A vibrant, growing economy that has room for us to pursue our dreams and our hopes. Because it doesn't matter how great an idea you have. It doesn't matter how innovative your product is. If people can't afford to buy it, if people can't afford to pay for it, you're not going to get very far. So the one goal is to grow our economy dynamically, or to create the conditions for our economy to grow dynamically. But the other thing that goes hand in hand with that is making sure that our people are prepared to take advantage of those opportunities. Because you can create all the great jobs in the world, but if your people do not have the skills to do that job, you're not going to be able to succeed in the goal that we have. And I think that we're falling short on both ends right now. And I actually started thinking about this when I was a state legislator. For example, for the life of me, I do not understand why over the last two decades we have stigmatized career education in America. You go to any hospital, at least in South Florida, and you look at the job postings, and it's opening after opening of good-paying jobs in the medical field that are not being filled. In fact, sometimes we are importing people from abroad to do these jobs in nursing and other sorts of things. Why aren't we producing that? Why aren't we creating capacity to educate people? That's just one example. Maybe it's different in different parts of the country. The point is, we all know, I have personally met kids, for example, that want to fix airplane engines or want to be a BMW technician, which, by the way, these jobs for an 18-year-old pay really well. Imagine if we could graduate kids from high school, not just with a high school diploma, but with an industry certification and a career. And there's nothing wrong with those jobs. Those are good jobs and we need them. By the same token, I think we need to be honest with our college graduates. I think we should have the freedom to study anything you want, but you deserve to know that if you're going to go into a certain major, when you graduate, here are the jobs that are available to you, and here are how much those jobs pay. And you should know that before you take out $50,000 in loans. And so when I leave here today, I'm going to be joining Senator Wyden, him and I are working together on a bipartisan basis to pass a bill called Right to Know Before You Go, which creates the mechanisms for this to be possible. Listen, I come from personal experience on that. You know, I graduated with over $125,000 in student loans. $125,000 in student loans. Every month, some lady called Sally Mae was taking $700 out of my account. So, if she's watching, no. Look. But the point is that we also need to recognize that we've got to re-examine how we pay for higher education. Because here's the brutal truth, and we've got to be honest with ourselves and with our kids. In the 21st century, there are going to be you will not be able to make enough money. There will not be good paying jobs for people that have no advanced education. That doesn't mean necessarily a four-year degree. That doesn't mean a PhD. That doesn't mean an MBA necessarily. But it does mean that unless you have a skill, you are going to really struggle to make it. And the sooner we tell that to kids and the more honest we are about that to ourselves and to the next generation, the better off we're going to be. But then we got to react to that. One thing is to recognize it. Another thing is to do something about it, to create the conditions where that's possible. Here's the other challenge we have. People will go into a career. And not only do you lose your job, but the entire industry you work for no longer exists because a new industry has replaced it. What do you do with people that are 35 years of age, studied in a certain field, and the field no longer exists? We've got to create mechanisms for those folks to be able to get retrained into a new career. And we may have to do that a couple of times in our lifetime. Again, that's a fact in the 21st century. Whether we like it or not, that's what we have. And that's what we should pursue. So these are the kinds of challenges we face, and everything we do should be through the lens of that. And here's the good news. I don't think this has to be a partisan issue. There's nothing partisan about opportunity. Now, look, for all the bad news you hear about the bickering in Washington, our parties, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, have a very honest difference of opinion about the role of government, the size of government, and what government should or should not be doing. That's a good debate to have. I hope we will continue to have it. What I do think we all agree on is that we want to be a country where if you have a good idea, you should be able to take it as far as it can go. And so the question that we should be debating is not who's a good guy and who's a bad guy, or who's a, you know, the debate we should be having is, what can we do to make that more possible? What can we do, given the challenges of this new century, to open those doors? Here's what I am 100% a believer in. I think the 21st century, I believe the 21st century has the very realistic opportunity of being the most prosperous century in human history. I do. I think more people will be pulled out of poverty in this new century than ever in human history. I think poverty will dramatically decline around the world. I think that this generation of Americans and the generations that will follow it have the chance to be the most secure and most prosperous generation of Americans ever. I know that's hard to believe with all the bad news that you hear in the press today, but I think that opportunity is there. Just think about what the 21st century means in practical terms. There are now millions of people all over the world who just a decade ago were living in deep poverty, who now have enough money in their pocket to buy the stuff that you might build or invent, to buy the services you offer, to visit the United States as tourists and leave money in your businesses, to be your partners in a business endeavor. And we have the technology to connect with them like never before. We have opportunities at collaboration that have never existed. You couldn't talk to someone halfway around the world before without having a huge long-distance bill. Now you can talk to them in real time for virtually zero cost. You used to only be able to collaborate with people that lived in your immediate vicinity. Now your business partner or the person you're collaborating with on the next great idea can live anywhere in the world as long as they have access to a mobile device that's linked to the net. Now, think about the opportunities in that. What about the opportunities of productivity? The ability to gain access to information faster than ever before. These are real opportunities that can dramatically change the quality of life on this planet for everyone, and which I think we are uniquely positioned to lead on because of our freedoms, because of our liberties, and because of our history of success. I also think, by the way, that we as a nation are uniquely positioned as a people to take advantage of the opportunities of the 21st century. Because it's no exaggeration to say that it's in our DNA. You've heard politicians in both parties say that. But think about who we are. Think about who you are. You are the descendant of a go-getter. Every single person in this room is the son, daughter, granddaughter, or grandson of someone who overcame extraordinary obstacles. Every single one of us. Think about what it meant. Think about what it meant to overcome not just the institution of slavery, but of segregation to stake your claim to the American dream. Think about what it meant to overcome having to immigrate to a country where you didn't speak the language and didn't know anybody and were able to get ahead in life. Their blood runs through our veins. That's who we are. And that's why the world's inspired by us. Even though there are many parts of the world where they get angry at us, where they protest against us, there is no nation on this planet that cannot find someone just like them here doing in this nation what they would never be able to do over there. That's who we are. That's who we've been. And we can be that now more than ever, if only we grasp the opportunities of this new century and pursue them. So I'm excited about this opportunity because, you see, at the end of the day, this is what gives purpose to public service. This is what makes it meaningful. This is what makes it fun to go to work every day, to know that you're working on stuff that's going to have a real impact. To be able to leave here, this place, whenever my service here is done and be able to tell my kids the reason why I was away from home so often, the reason why I missed some activities that maybe I wish I hadn't missed in your lives is because I was making a difference. Because I was out working on behalf of these sorts of things. We're not going to get it all right, but we can get most of it right, a lot of it right, in very real ways to impact real people. And that's what I'm excited about the opportunity to be a part of. So we're going to have an election. These elections are going to get contentious. People are going to say mean things about each other, as you well know, and it's already happening. People are going to be divided about these issues. That's our republic. But I hope after this election, irrespective of the outcome, we will all as a nation come to recognize this extraordinary chance we have of making this new century the most exciting time in human history, and the unique opportunity we have as Americans, not just to lead by example, but to create for our people a chance of prosperity that no people have ever known. There's nothing wrong with our people. The American people, the young men and women that I run into every single day, especially this new generation, people under the age of 25, that are the greatest collaborators in the history of the world. They're already used to, just by the way they've grown up working with people on stuff. I've met some of the smartest people I've ever known who today are not doing well in school. You know why? Because their curriculum isn't speaking to their hopes and dreams. If only we could get them into a place where they're studying stuff they like. Because as my dad used to tell me, he used to say it in Spanish, so it's not going to sound as good, but in English, let me tell you what it translates to. He used to say, if you do something that you like but you're not good at it, it's called a hobby. If you do something that you're good at but you don't like, it's called a job. But if you get to do something that you love and that you're good at, that's a career. And that's what we need, careers. And what we want to figure out, and that so in my life I had hobbies. You know, I loved football. The problem is there weren't a lot of 5'9", 170 pounders in the National Football League. So, and had it not been for my lack of size, speed, and talent, I would have played in the NFL. So that was my hobby. Then I went to work at a law firm billing hours, and you know, I went to a law degree, and that was, I mean, I went to nightlife, but I didn't love doing that. I didn't love billing hours at a law firm, and that was my job. But at least now, at this stage in my life, I have an opportunity to make public service, to make public policy, and to bring my life experience to that realm. I love what I do, and I hope I'll be good at it, because if I am, it'll give purpose and meaning to it, and then I can say I had a career. Although I hope it won't be the only career I have in my life. But the point is that this is the chance we have to do for people all over this country. This is the opportunity before us. And I hope we'll take it. It's a unique one. It's an exciting one. And I'm just glad at what Opportunity Nation is doing to bring people together from all across this country. I, for one, hope that I can become a leader on this issue, working with all of you and with my colleagues in the United States Senate to ensure that the next couple years becomes the opportunity agenda. Thank you for having me. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Chelsea Slater, and I'm from Boston, Mass. My parents divorced when I was 16 years old. 2 years later, I graduated high school. At that point, I got accepted to the Academy of Art University, which is the largest private art school in the United States, and it's in San Francisco. I got accepted on my portfolio alone. Come to find out, it was my dream school. I couldn't wait to go, but even after full financial aid, I still had to pay $1,000 to go. I couldn't afford it. My dream was crushed. So I figured, okay, you know what, I'll go to a state school. Why not try UMass Boston? It's a state school, I should be able to afford it, right? Well, no, that was expensive too, and I wound up having to drop out. So I stand before you today. I work 2 jobs. I go to school full-time at Bunker Hill Community College in Charlestown, Massachusetts. I have a 3.9 GPA. I'm graduating this spring with a GPA even higher than that. And I have a dream of being able to go to a private 4-year college and obtaining a bachelor's degree. You ever wonder what type of people go to a community college? Motivated, hardworking people that want a leg up in life, that want something better for themselves than their families had before them. But it's not always that easy. There are students there that go on academic probation because they had to drop out of school to take care of their families. At Bunker Hill Community College, we have selective programs, nursing, medical imaging, NSTAR programs, programs that lead people into jobs with a real demand. The healthcare field is ever growing, and there are students there that want to learn and want to be engaged and have a career. Every year, each selective program has 25 slots, and every year, 300 students apply for each of those slots. So I stand before you right now. I'm graduating this year. I go to a community college. I don't stop. I won't stop moving until I find that it's my time to stop, until I decide this is where I want to end. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michelle Nunn, CEO, Points of Light, and co-founder, Hands On Network.
Let's give it one more round of applause for Chelsea for that amazing testimonial. Today we've heard inspiring stories from folks like Chelsea and from the extraordinary young people earlier today. We've heard experts and academics, we've heard political leaders talk about the opportunity nation that we must create together. But I wanted to tell you a little bit, I want to share with you a little bit about your voices, the voices and the stories and the ideas that were generated in the breakout sessions that we had over lunch. And your voices are actually what will be key to advancing this movement of opportunity. And it will not be sufficient to have just the leaders that are speaking from this podium that are behind this, but it is imperative and necessary for us to engage the voices, the creativity, the muscle, and the perseverance, and the passion of our citizenry. And you all represent that. You all represent the leaders that will carry us forward. So let me tell you just a little bit about the breakout sessions. How were the breakout sessions? Did everybody? So there were 10 breakout sessions. They're listed in your program. Everything, covering everything from how do we engage the media in this cause, to how do we fight gridlock in Congress, to advance legislation and public policy. And so let me just tell you a couple of the ideas, just a few of the ideas that were generated. One of the ideas was we must move from a binary conversation about too little government or too much government. We must talk about public-private partnerships. We must talk about coming together and how the three legs of our stool will work together to form the bedrock of opportunity and optimism and possibility for America. We also heard an announcement. One of our sessions, Jobs for the Future, announced a new collaborative effort to increase the number of Americans without diplomas who were involved in post-secondary education. So listen to this. They have committed that they will put 40,000 people through these pathways in 5 states. So give them a round of applause. By 2014. We also talked about how important it is to ensure that parents and students are at the table at the conversations about finances for college, for community college, for technical educational experiences. We must have them at the table, and we must create transparency around finances for higher ed. We also talked in the session that I was in about how volunteering can be a pathway for opportunity, and also how volunteers can support this effort. And we talked about how the index is a really great tool to get people to mobilize over the long term, to think about the long-term trajectory for how we create an opportunity nation. We talked about creating a national Kickstarter for civic projects. And we also talked during our sessions about the media, how the media is more interested in individual stories than they are about problem solving. But we must use those individual stories, the kind of stories that we've heard today, to help them see and to tell our story of programs that work and how we can scale those programs. So we had another announcement from the Rockefeller Foundation, in which they committed over $1 million for a prize for the best solution to leverage the assets of youth through small business. So this all just happened over lunch today. So let's give ourselves a hand. We talked about transforming technical education, making it the prestigious pathway that it needs to be, making it more effective and efficient, and a whole host of other ideas. And perhaps most of all, we had passionate youth talk with authentic voices about how they're going to use a council of young people to create change across this country. So give yourselves a round of applause for these great ideas, for the great stories that you all told. And as we move forward with the Opportunity Nation plan, these are the topics, these are the ideas that will fuel our efforts. We're going to take all of these ideas and we're going to pull them together for the Opportunity Nation plan going forward. And let me just reinforce that it is truly you thousand folks that are gathered here today that can animate the millions more that need to be mobilized in order for us to create and fulfill the vision that has been articulated today. So let's keep those conversations going and let's keep the movement going for an Opportunity Nation. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our panelists, Meg Garlinghouse from LinkedIn, Cheryl Oldham, U.S. Chamber of Commerce, David Nagel, BP North America, Denise Hebner, UBS, and our moderator, Judy Woodruff, Senior Correspondent, PBS NewsHour.
Hello, everybody. I am just delighted. I'm thrilled to be here with all of you. What a fabulous program. You had so many amazing speakers. I wish I could. I've actually interviewed a few of you for a report the NewsHour is doing on young voters. I was so excited to be able to do that. And right now, I am really thrilled to be part of this amazing panel. You are going to meet four extraordinary individuals who come from the business community, and each of the organizations they represent has already taken steps to engage with young people broadly and to engage with, I guess the word we're using is disconnected youth. And it's the subject that you're here to talk about, and it's something each one of them is very, very interested in. So I'm going to introduce them, and then I'm going to ask them to tell us what their company or their organization is doing in working with young people. Meg Garlinghouse, I'm going to start with you. She is the head of social impact at LinkedIn. So Meg, start out by telling us what LinkedIn is doing with young people, and in particular disconnected youth.
Sure. So we are working with disconnected youth in two ways. One, we have a really terrific partnership with Year Up, which I know there's a big... We are big, big, big Year Up fans, and we've actually helped Year Up expand their offices down in Silicon Valley. I think we were the first tech company to take on Year Up interns, and I wanted to tell a quick story, if I may. And it echoes one of the themes that came up earlier, that we see this partnership not as a charitable investment. We see this as an enormous business opportunity, and when Scott Donahue came and met with our director of IT a year and a half ago and sat down, he didn't say, "Hey, LinkedIn, are you interested in hiring a bunch of disconnected youth?" He sat down and he said, "Hey, LinkedIn, would you like to hire some extraordinary individuals who are highly motivated, and by the way, they're pre-trained in hard and soft skills to be your next exceptional IT workers?" We said, "Yeah, actually, we'll take six." So it was a really, really easy business decision for us to make, and I just want to really make that clear that we are doing this because it's the right thing for our business, and by the way, we think it also gives these individuals an opportunity that they may not have had previously.
Terrific, Meg. And everybody, by the way, knows what LinkedIn is, right? I just want to be sure.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Cheryl Oldham, who's sitting right next to Meg. Cheryl is Vice President of the Institute for a Competitive Workforce at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And quickly, Cheryl, for the young people who may not be familiar, explain what the U.S. Chamber does,
sure,
and then tell us about your connection with young people.
Sure. So the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is one of the largest trade associations in Washington, D.C., and a lot of what we do, we essentially are the largest organization representing the interests of business in this country. And so we represent the voices of about 3 million business people across the nation. And really the strength of the chamber is in its local chambers. So there's local chambers of commerce all across the country in communities everywhere. And they are very engaged with obviously youth and others in their community. And they tell us every single day how they are struggling with a skills gap. They can't find people to fill jobs that are available with the skills required. And this is, you know, exactly the kind of thing that we're talking about today, and the kinds of things that we do at the chamber. We engage in policy and we engage in advocacy to try to
you know, sort of affect change here at Washington, but also at the state level.
Great. Thank you, Cheryl. Sitting next to Cheryl is David Nagel. He is Executive Vice President of BP North America. BP, of course, the oil company, so you don't need to tell us what the oil company is. But tell us, Dave, what are you doing? What is the company doing right now in working with young people and in particular with disconnected young people?
Thanks, Judy. It's great to be with you all here today. We're the second largest producer of oil and gas in this country. We've got about 23,000 employees, but there's nearly 250,000 jobs in our supply chain. And the energy future for this country is bright. The future for manufacturing is bright. But when I talk to the manufacturers, the match between the skills that need to be done due to the high technologies in our industry and the workforce coming through, there's not always a match. And so things that we're doing, we're working with schools, whether it's high schools, community colleges, universities, on helping this. We work with the National Action Council of Minorities in Engineering to try to create a pipeline of engineers. And I'm here actually with a Boy Scout hat on because we're very involved in the Explorer program, which is designed for 14 to 20-year-olds to help them try to get a better read on what their career interests might be.
And my apology, I was supposed to mention the Boy Scouts when I introduced you, but that's the other part of what Dave is representing. Our final panelist is Denise Hebner. She is Head of Diversity and Inclusion Americas at UBS. So Denise, tell us first what UBS is, what it does, and then tell us about what you're doing with young people.
So UBS is a financial firm. We're based in Switzerland, have been in existence this year. We celebrated our 150th anniversary. So we work with high net worth clients and provide them financial solutions. We have an investment bank, global asset management. So what are we doing with young adults? So the challenge that we had faced with UBS was how do we create a workforce that emulates the communities that the firm operates in? Because we found the universities were not producing enough women, Hispanics, and people of African descent who were studying technology and financial curriculums. So what we did, we decided to create an intern academy, so literally we're manufacturing our own pipeline. And the way we do that is I work with high schools in New York City. I also work with programs like Year Up. So, and I do have bragging rights. Four of my interns, wherever they are out there. So two from New York and two from Chicago. And we provide internships, so it's a 6-month program, and it's all about exposure because when they start with us, they don't understand what it looks like to be in this industry. What could a technology career look like? And what we find is once they start feeling it out and getting the experience, they now switch into an IT curriculum, and we are literally changing what that dynamic looks like at university.
Terrific. Okay, so we've heard from each of the panelists. I want to go back and talk to each one of you about why it makes sense. You've touched on this. You've talked about the skills gap. But why does it make sense? And coming back to you, Meg, you were telling me before we came out here that LinkedIn has its own platform that's designed to do what we're talking about today. Tell the audience and all of us about that.
So what I was saying is, you know, this audience segment is important to LinkedIn, not just as an employer, but as part of our platform. We are really, really committed and interested in making sure that youth are part of the LinkedIn platform. Our vision at LinkedIn is to create economic opportunity for professionals around the world. And that's not just the person who just graduated from business school, it's anyone who has a professional career dream. And so that's you in the audience right now. And part of the challenge, as you guys probably know, is social mobility is hard if you don't have social capital. So if you didn't grow up in a community where you have connections to people in these jobs, it's gonna be harder for you to access those. The LinkedIn platform is in some ways an equalizer. And I just strongly encourage you guys, if you're not on LinkedIn now, to join LinkedIn. And I encourage the professionals in the audience to reach out and connect with a person who may not have the normal connections that some of us grew up with. I think it's an extraordinary opportunity. Networks are you know, what makes the world go round, and as well as pathways to career profession. If you identify someone whose job you want, look them up on LinkedIn, see how they got where they were, reach out to them, send them an email, and see if they'll meet you for coffee. It's an extraordinary way to make important connections.
And just quickly, Meg, can you give us an example of how that could work? I mean, somebody in a particular field, how could that work on LinkedIn?
Sure. So let's say you are interested in a career in social media marketing. I'll be egocentric about it. You could reach out to me, for example, and or you could actually, even a better example is go on LinkedIn. We have an advanced search tab, and you actually can search on skill. You could say, I'm interested in talking to someone who has mobile skills, works at Facebook, and went to University of Kansas. You can search on that, and they'll come up with a search result, and you can reach out and connect with that person.
Cheryl, tell us more about why at the Chamber your businesses, you talked about the skills gap, but talk about the reality of that. What does it mean when businesses can't find the young people who they need to fill certain positions, and how do you make those connections in the communities?
Well, I mean, what it means is, you know, jobs are going unfilled in this high economic, you know, in this sort of crazy economic time we're in, and high unemployment, yet jobs are going unfilled, and it's heartbreaking, really. I mean, there's great jobs out there, and, you know, our members tell us we're having a hard time filling them. I mean, what is the biggest sort of, you know, indicator of opportunity in this country is education and the type of education that you get. And so that's why we're so focused on the whole pipeline, right? Starting from K through 12 and all of the challenges that we're having in that system and the things that we can do. And the business community is extremely engaged in sort of policy and how do we make sure that every child is getting the education they deserve, you know, with a specific focus. I mean, we're still not graduating half of, you know, African-American males on time in this country. I mean, that's, you know, you're not going to get a job and you're not going to be able to succeed if you can't graduate from high school. And then questions about the quality of the high school diploma that you are getting. And then obviously issues with the workforce development system and higher education, as Senator Rubio talked about. The data in higher education is so severely lacking. It's so critical what he's promoting with Senator Wyden to say, you know, you should have that information about what it's going to cost you and can you get a job and what am I, you know, before you sort of invest in this huge, you know, life investment for yourself.
What would you add to that, David Nagel, both from the Boy Scouts perspective and from the BP perspective?
Well, I think I'd start exploring is different than when I was a Boy Scout a long time ago. Exploring is all about careers. It's for men and women from all walks of life, ages 14 to 20, and they gather in explore posts and explore one of 12 different career areas. Some of the most interesting ones to folks are aviation and science and engineering, but there's also arts and the humanities. And they meet once or twice a month for a couple hours, and there are over 5,000 of these across the country. And the main purpose is to get practical experience working with people to try to find out, is this a career area that you're interested in, or actually as important, you know what, I really don't like this, so that you don't spend a lot of time studying for something only to find out that it's not what you want to do. And I encourage folks to look at that. The other thing that they have is they have an online survey tool. They also have a paper tool for people that don't have access to the internet, but it's called exploringyourcareer.com. And it lets you look at, in about 6 to 10 minutes, 200 career fields, and it's free to the schools, and it's a tool that everybody can use, and it's widely accessed and widely enjoyed by the guidance counselors and so on. It's just a way of honing in and understanding what the interests are. And the leading careers are in the health fields, in nursing, but also in teaching, and also in the military. So that's kind of what the survey data is telling people about what's out there. But it's a great, rich resource. There are over 100,000 folks involved in it right now, and about 3 million have gone through it over the last 15 years.
And Boy Scouts are in most communities, is that right?
Yeah, they are. Every They're all community. Over the country, and volunteers all over the place.
Terrific. Denise Hebner, pick up on this. I mean, talk some more from the perspective of a financial institution like UBS. That's not a perspective we've you know, the other three have represented. Why does it make sense to have this kind of a connection with young people, and particularly with those young people who maybe haven't had the advantages that others have?
Well, the sustainability of an organization like UBS is how thriving the communities are. So if we're operating in communities like New York, which does have a high number of disconnected or say underemployed young adults, we cannot continue to thrive. So it's important to actually build up the community so they can join the economic mainstream. And the other thing is, we provide financial solutions. So as the demographics are changing, so we're seeing a higher number of African Americans and Hispanics who are accumulating wealth, we need to start looking more like them. So we have to get more of that talent in the organization. So it all comes down to the business case of why is it important to have diverse talent, and that's part of it. And I think to tap into some of the comments made earlier is, I think a lot of corporations could give more thought to getting more involved into the schools. We talked about this in a table discussion earlier, that there seems to be a systemic problem with the education system. So if we can take the millions and millions of employed workers and have them get more involved in the school systems earlier in with the mentoring, with the reading, and start as young as, say, the second grade and follow the student through, I think you'll see improvement with the graduation rates, and we can actually change this trend.
Let me just very briefly ask each one of you to say what it is that your organization, your company, has as your goal. I mean, what more do you want to achieve in the next few years in this area? Starting with you, Meg.
Sure. Core of the skills gap issue is really understanding the skills gap. So for example, in Detroit, if there's a skills gap there, is it there's too many auto mechanics and not enough neurosurgeons, or is it too many auto mechanics and not enough telecommunication service people? And if it's the latter, well, there are very, very actionable things that we together can do about that. So I think making this information more transparent about what the supply and demand of the skills gap really looks like is super important. I think it's an opportunity for LinkedIn to play, since we sit on mounds and mounds of data that can help put a magnifying glass on this.
Cheryl, what about with the Chambers of Commerce?
So I think we are really going to focus, starting tomorrow actually, with a convening we're having specifically focused on the skills gap called Help Wanted. And I mean, I think we need to make some serious reforms to, for example, the Workforce Investment Act. I mean, this is the, you know, federal government's major investment, partnership with communities to really train folks in jobs that are available. And we need to do such a better job of understanding what are the jobs available in that community. And that really is what should be happening through these local workforce boards, and we should be training people for jobs available in those communities. And so that's what we're really going to take a hard look at.
David Nagel, what about BP and the Boy Scouts?
In some ways, it's the same story. In a lot of the communities where we work, we have jobs. We need to make sure that the folks that live there have the skills to be able to do those, and so we work with the community colleges, we work with the high schools and the universities to get and to develop those skills and to continue to match those. And with the Boy Scouts, they're on that same path, and then there's another resource that the Boy Scouts utilizes. I mentioned that over 100,000 folks are involved as participants in the Explorer program. They're supported by almost 30,000 adult volunteers that are in there, that know their industries, know the skills, and really are dedicated to helping people get practical experience, not stuff that you can just read about. I mean, that's good. But to actually find out how this works and build up your leadership skills and your own self-confidence.
And Denise, what about UBS?
So with UBS, we ran a mentoring program in a Brooklyn high school. In the past 4 years, what we've seen by meeting with the students every Monday for the school year, those students who are involved in the program, 90% of them actually were promoted to the next level. That's 20 percentage points higher than the average for the school. So a commitment that the firm is making is getting more involved with the middle and the high school and providing this mentoring, because we think it's critical. The other thing outside of Year Up, which we're going to be expanding.
<let's see. laughs>
So with the Europe, it's expanding into other functions in the organization. Right now we're in operations, HR, and IT, and to take that platform, because these young adults can do more than IT. They're analytical, they're motivated, they have innovative ideas on how to make process improvement or cost avoidance. And then the other thing that we've started is Elevating Entrepreneurs. It's a program where we're working with small businesses and providing them financial resources from a advisory standpoint, connecting them with successful clients that we have in that industry to help them take their business to the next level. Because since 1980, most jobs have been created from small businesses. So we feel that.
We've only got 20 seconds left. So let me ask each of you in 10 or 15 seconds to tell anybody out there listening, watching, either for themselves or the people they know, their friends, if they're interested in doing something with LinkedIn, what should they know? What should they do, Meg?
Well, if you don't already have a LinkedIn profile, sign up. It takes literally 10 seconds. And if you do have one, reach out to someone you know who may be fall into the category of disconnected youth and ask them to connect.
From the chamber perspective, I'd say, local chambers are definitely a great way to sort of connect with various partnerships and opportunities and things happening in a community. If you're a business leader out there, I would say, get engaged in these issues in a real and meaningful way, like all of these folks are. It's kind of sort of time to get off the bench on some
David.
Of this.
Real quickly, if you or someone you know is interested in the Exploring program, either to participate or as an adult volunteer, contact the Boy Scouts in your district. They're across the country.
Okay. Finally?
I've forgotten the question.
The question is, for any young person out there who's interested in what UBS is doing and wants to know more about it, wants to connect, what would you suggest they do?
If you want to connect, you can research our website. You can send me an email, denise.hebner@ubs.com. The way to get into our organization in this program is through a connection with a Year Up or an Empower. And I guess to use a Year Up phrase is, you have to lift as you climb, so do not forget where you came from.
Let's thank all of these panelists. Aren't they terrific? Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Patricia Stonecipher, former chair of the White House Council for Community Solutions.
Good afternoon. There we go. It's a dark room, but you've got lots of energy. We'll do it again. Good afternoon. On behalf of the White House Council for Community Solutions, I want to thank Opportunity Nation for their commitment to improving this country and giving us all the chance to come together to commit to improving opportunity for all youth. In 2010, President Obama brought together our council from business and education, philanthropy and government, and even with the considerable efforts of Jon Bon Jovi from the rock star industry. The president asked us to help identify and raise awareness of effective community-based solutions to our nation's most serious problems. Well, this was a serious council, and we listened, studied, and chose very quickly to zero in on one essential community need, putting every young person on a clear pathway to economic opportunity. As you know all too well, and you've heard from numerous speakers today, the future is ominous for the 6.7 million 16 to 24-year-olds who are disconnected from school and jobs. They are currently off the key pathways that led me and the other speakers you've heard from to economic independence. And it's costing them dearly, but it's also costing our cities, our states, and our nations over $90 billion per year by having these opportunity youth lacking opportunity. But our research confirmed that these young Americans want to get back on track, are ready to work extremely hard to do so, take personal responsibility for their future, and want to give back to their families and their communities but they just need a little help. So that's why we came together today, and that's why the White House Council put forth a series of recommendations on what it will take for the governments, for our cities, for our nonprofits, for our businesses, to create opportunities for all opportunity youth. And I won't repeat all those recommendations here, or we'd be here till tomorrow. But I want to highlight three of our most important that are 100% aligned with the shared plan that Opportunity Nation has released today. First and foremost is the authentic youth voice and leadership at the core of all solutions. Opportunity youth know what they need, and they trust their peers more than they trust most other people, for pretty good reasons, given the experiences they've had thus far. So it's my belief, and it was our council's belief, that whether you're the mayor of San Francisco, the CEO of Amazon or LinkedIn, or the nonprofit leader running a youth or family organization, you need to bring young people to the table, not just as a feel-good effort, but to listen, learn, and let them lead us to improved solutions for all young people. Out of those recommendations came the collective impact, engage employers, absolutely critical to achieving the objectives that we all have been talking about today. So we've got something very special going. We've got visibility with people like Judy Woodruff and Arianna Huffington and others at the table, passionate about this issue and ready to put the spotlight on it. We've got a shared agenda, the youth, the Opportunity Nation, the White House Council and others coming forward. But now we need the resources and we need the implementation. And that's going to take sustained commitment by all of us. And I'm really pleased and proud, representing the White House Council, but also as an individual leader, to be joining you here today as we begin to take these shared agendas and move them to the increased resources and increased impact that we're all seeking. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Andrew Plepler, Global Corporate Social Responsibility Executive and Consumer Policy Executive, Bank of America.
Thank you. Thank you. I've been listening to some of the prior speakers, and I realize that the quickest way to get a louder round of applause than that is to mention one of your organizations. So, is City Year here? There you go. Year up. That's too easy, as my son says. Exactly. Look, I've been involved in the connecting youth area for quite a long time in my career. It began back in 1996. I'm not going to take you through a whole history of my career, but in 1996, I attended an event around youth violence here in Washington, D.C. And it was a panel of youth of about 10 kids, and they were asked by then Vice President Al Gore what the most important thing to overcome youth violence would be in their eyes. And without exception, they all said a job. And they all had friends who were involved in violence, they all had experienced it, and they all talked about the importance of a good job. And at the end of that session, the stage was sort of overrun with people who were delivering their business cards to these kids who had been on the panel and had spoken so eloquently. And I then went out to Anacostia High School about 2 weeks later, and I tracked down one of the kids, and I asked about all the business cards she had collected that day. And she was really sort of overwhelmed with emotion and said, "None of them returned my call. I followed up, you know, I did everything they told me to do, and I couldn't get anywhere." And it was that sense of frustration and disappointment that I found really moving at the time. And it was this sense of the short attention span that I think people and adults in particular have to this issue of connecting youth and engaging youth in meaningful opportunities, and it's an issue for the day, and then we all move on with our lives, and it became apparent to me then how powerful that short attention span could be and the impact that it could have on young people's lives. And that was really when I began an organization called the Urban Alliance Foundation, which is a program, youth development program here in DC, now proudly expanded to Baltimore and about to expand to Chicago. Exactly. And a shout out to the legendary executive director of Urban Alliance, Veronica Nolan, who's here today. So truly one of the beacons in the field. And at the time, we started with about six kids and now have served over 1,000 kids in DC and Baltimore, and will soon, as I said, expand to Chicago, really engaging young people in a meaningful work experience that leads to a career opportunity, that really helps youth plan their lives, plans their careers. And what I'm proud of working at Bank of America to transition fast forward 16 years is Bank of America's had a long attention span to this issue of youth development. And you heard my colleague Carrie Sullivan talk earlier today about our student leader initiative that served about 2,000 youth since it began in 2004. Putting students in nonprofit experiences, exposing them to the careers of the nonprofit sector, engaging them in their communities, and really beginning to think about the long term of their lives. We're also very engaged in putting students in our own workplace. Urban Alliance students and others have participated in our banking center, serving as convenient ways to bank ambassadors, using the savviness of young people with technology, teaching people how to use ATMs, how to bank mobily, how to bank more effectively as opposed to the old-fashioned way of going into the banking center waiting for the teller. This really is a skill set that young people have that folks like myself don't have that can really serve them in their careers. We're really trying to introduce them to the careers in banking in that way. And finally, working with mayors across the country on summer jobs programs. This summer, we employed over 1,000, helped to fund the employment of over 1,000 students in organizations and cities in partnership with mayors. So this is really a program around the private sector, the nonprofit sector, and government. We all need to be engaged. We all need to have a long attention span. We can't show up for a day and then forget about this issue. If we're going to overcome 25% and higher unemployment among youth today, we need to pay attention to this issue for the long haul. So my call to action I am Jewish, and we just celebrated Rosh Hashanah on Monday, absolutely. It is a time for reflection. It's a time for renewal. Unfortunately, next week, Yom Kippur is a time for repentance. So I'm not going to ask all of you to fast with me next week on Wednesday, but if you so choose, you know who you are who need to repent. You can do that on Wednesday, sunset Tuesday to sunset Wednesday. In this time of reflection and renewal, let us all go forward today to realize that we need to pay attention to this issue for a long-term commitment. Let's come together in 5 years and really make sure we've made a dent in the youth unemployment and the youth who are disconnected. We can get at this issue. We can solve this issue if we do it together. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Arianna Huffington, President and Editor-in-Chief, the Huffington Post Media Group.
Thank you so much. I'm really, really excited to be here. I'm particularly excited to be away from covering this campaign. It's like watching a split screen. On the one hand, is diminished expectations from our political leaders, and on the other hand, is growing expectations from our young leaders collected here. Thank you so much for what you are doing. And I'm here as a member of the media to say that we in the media also have a responsibility that we have not been doing our part to actually cover what is working, to put the spotlight on the good things happening. We are all, of course, covering everything that is dysfunctional, and there is plenty that is dysfunctional at the moment, especially here in Washington, D.C. But also, we need to do a much better job covering the incredible examples of ingenuity, creativity, compassion, empathy that you are demonstrating here today. This is our responsibility, and at the Huffington Post, we take it very seriously. That's why we have launched dedicated sections. One of them, which has become incredibly popular, is our good news section. It only publishes good news. So any good news that you have, anything good that you are doing, please send it to me. I'm going to give you right now my email address. You can send it to me personally, and we'd love you to blog about it, to send us pictures about it, to send us video about it, to actually have a platform where you can celebrate everything good happening right now in your communities, in your neighborhoods, in America, around the world. So my email address is very simple, Ariana, with one R and two N's, at HuffingtonPost.com. Easy, right? So the other section that we have is called Impact. And impact is about all the things that are having an impact in the world, all the things that are happening by companies, by not-for-profits, by individuals. And another feature is called the greatest person of the day. You can nominate someone who is doing something good, and we'll celebrate them as the greatest person of the day, not of the year, but of the day. We need to celebrate the good obsessively. And the latest section that we launched is called Opportunity, What is Working? And we've partnered with LinkedIn, with YearUp, with the... Hi, YearUp! We love YearUp! With Startup America, Venture USA, basically everybody that is doing something about creating jobs. Because this is our big objective at the Huffington Post, to do our part to actually get companies, not-for-profits, foundations, and individuals do their part to create jobs. And you know why? Because we cannot just stand idly by waiting for Washington to solve this problem. We now have 23 million people in this country who are unemployed or underemployed, many of them young, many of them graduating from college, burdened with debt and not being able to get a job. I have two daughters myself who are in college, so I know how big this problem is. And we cannot wait for a knight on a white charger to come riding to our rescue. We just have to rescue ourselves. So our objective is twofold. One is to get major commitments, and we've already been very successful at getting commitments. For example, the Ford Foundation has very generously committed $150 million over the next 5 years to help close the skills gap. Because they're over, as you know, there are over 3 million job openings, but somehow the people who are looking for jobs don't have the right set of skills. There is a lot we can do about it, and there are some great people at community colleges, in corporations, in foundations, doing a lot about it. The Ford Foundation is committing $150 million to help. The Rockefeller Foundation is launching a competition on the Huffington Post and on Twitter for the most innovative job creation idea. So anybody here who has an innovative job creation idea, please participate in this competition. And do you know how much you can get from the Rockefeller Foundation?
$1 million.
Then the Skoll Foundation, we have partnered with the Skoll Foundation, and their challenge, their competition, is among not-for-profits. If you are running a not-for-profit and you have a job creation idea, as of October 1st, go to the Huffington Post. We are calling the competition Job Raising. Come up with an innovative idea for job creation among not-for-profits, and the Skoll Foundation has committed $250,000, and we are raising another $250,000 through Edward Norton's organization, through the crowd, the people contributing to match what the Skoll Foundation is doing. And there's a lot more commitments, and they are coming every day. We're working, you've heard Alan Kazai and John Bridgman, who's been speaking here. We're working with them to keep innovating around job creation. The second reason for doing that is that we need to change the narrative away from this fatalistic hopelessness that is permeating the country at the moment, and towards the belief once again that, as John Gardner said, what we have before us are some breathtaking opportunities disguised as insoluble problems. So what we need to capture is that spirit of the greatest generation. At both conventions, we had a lunch panel that Tom Brokaw, who wrote about the greatest generation, moderated. And the greatest generation was really that moment in America when we faced our challenges head on, and when people came together in extraordinary collective effort, both to win the war and to rebuild the country after the war. And Tom Brokaw spoke about how in his home, there was like something sacred about the victory bonds that his parents bought. Tens of millions of Americans bought victory bonds to support the war effort, even when they couldn't afford it. Because that's really the spirit of the greatest generation. That's the spirit that we need to summon again. And one of my favorite things during one of the panels was what Walter Isaacson, the president of the Aspen Institute, said, when he said, you know, every commencement speaker goes out there and tells you to follow your passion, right? And Walter said, you know what? It ain't just about you and your damn passion. It has to be about something larger than yourself. And this is that moment when we can capture that and then make our lives have real significance beyond ourselves, beyond our immediate families, beyond our immediate circle of friends. That's really the moment. And it's in the zeitgeist. It's out there. When we tap into it, I really believe we're going to have the wind on our back, and we're going to have that extension of grace that can quickly help us reach a critical mass, quickly reach that tipping point. And if there is anybody here, although I don't think there could possibly be anybody here who wonders what can one person do, if there is anybody, just a single person here who wonders that, I want you to contemplate being in bed with a mosquito. Just a tiny little mosquito, and think how much havoc it can wrought. So you're never too small to make a big difference. And so I just want to end by going back to John Gardner. What we have before us are some breathtaking opportunities disguised as insoluble problems. So let's summon up that spirit of the greatest generation and go out there and solve them. Thank you. And have the best part for last. I'm going to introduce an amazing 22-year-old, Jordan Sparks.
Hello.
She gorgeous. So backstage, you know, in the green room, we were talking, and I met her amazing mother. Wait until you meet her mother. You know, we must bring your mother out here, because first of all, you will not believe it's her mother.
Mom, should we mom, bring her out
yes.
in a second?
Can we? Can mom? We bring? Can we bring Jordan's mom out here? We will, don't worry, we're not leaving until she comes out here.
But she's probably having a heart attack right now.
she was telling, I asked her, how come the Jordan, who of course won the American Idol at 17, and then went on to make a difference in terms of many, many things, including Malaria No More, and now this great new organization that she launched called MAD, Make a Difference, which is all about taking the legitimate anger that very often we feel when we are confronted with injustice, when we are confronted with all the terrible things around us, and doing something about it. So I said to her mom, so how did that happen? You know, did you bring her up that way? And she said, yes. At Christmas, for example, she and her brother, they would bring in their presents, and then they would have to give some of their presents away. Mm-hmm. And Jordan said that's why she was sad every Christmas.
Trying to remember, oh, that's why I was crying. I had to get rid of my toys. But it's good, though. My parents definitely instilled that in me and my brother when we were young, that, you know, if you have a platform, and even if you don't, just go out and do something for somebody else, or go out and try to impact your community, or to impact maybe even your friend if they need something. So it's all about just going out there and making that difference and taking that step to do it.
In fact, you were telling me how one of your best friends, for example, can't get a job at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
So what does this mean for you? How do you deal with it?
It's been a little bit crazy because with my career and traveling all over the place, sometimes I don't really know about things until I get back home. And so I was sitting with him for a little bit and just talking with him, like, how are you doing? How's the job hunt? And, you know, he's been looking for, he's been looking for a while. And it's been really difficult for him to get a job. And I know that there's a lot of, kids that I went to school with that are now, you know, either just about to graduate college or are out of college that are still looking for a job. You know, they have degrees and, you know, they can't find a job. And what you guys were telling me is that, you know, there are 3.2 million jobs right now that are available, and it doesn't make sense that there are people looking and can't find one, yet there are so many available. So it's difficult. You know, I'm still learning. I'm myself learning about how to correlate the two and how to get them together and how to fix it. But it takes more than one person, you know, it takes more than one person to get the voices heard.
And that's really the goal of MAD, right? So tell us a little bit about MAD. How did it come about? What was the idea behind it?
Well, like I said, my parents, they instilled in us giving back. But MAD came about when, in September 2009, I was going to New York City. And I went down to baggage claim, and there was TVs at baggage claim to watch. And the news was on, and it was about the story that they were telling was about Darian Albert. He was a kid who was just walking home from school in Chicago, and he was beaten to death. There was a fight, and he was just walking past it, and somehow he got pulled into it, and he was killed, and kids around him were videotaping, and nobody did anything. And I just remember standing in the middle of baggage claim, and I started bawling. And I went back to my hotel, and I called my mom, and I was like, Mom, I'm so angry. I'm so mad that nobody did anything and that people just stood around. And that's kind of where the whole thing started. My mom, you know, she took that, and she was at home, so she couldn't hug me, but she was thinking about it. And then she came up with, I'm mad at you. You know, you see something, you get mad about it, it stirs up your spirit, and you go out and you want to make that difference. So you go out and you be mad. You go out and make a difference. So it's a play on words, but that's how it came
about. And that's
about
the hashtag.
Actually, right now, I asked all my Twitter followers right before I came out here to let me know how they're making a difference using the hashtag I Matter You, which is another way that we can, you know, get things out. The internet obviously isn't going anywhere, and it reaches worldwide, so you can reach a lot of people that way, and that's how I use my Twitter as well, as I talk about things that I'm passionate about or organizations that I've partnered with. And so with the hashtag, now my fans can tell me how they're making a difference, and they'll say, this is what I'm doing, and they put the hashtag there, and then when people want to know what the hashtag is, they click on it, and then they know that it's about making a difference.
And also, you take an emotion which you associate with something negative, like
right.
being mad, mm-hmm. and you are turning it into something positive, making
exactly.
a difference.
Mm-hmm.
I love that. I love the paradox of that.
Thank you.
And as you look at your celebrity and your platform and using it for good, what is the message for people who may not have celebrity or platform, but have that drive to actually make a difference in the world?
It's definitely crazy, because we were doing stuff, or me and my family, you know, we were going, you know, on Thanksgiving to go to the Salvation Army or different things like that before I even did Idol. So it was something that we were always really passionate about, but there's so many people out there who don't know, well, what can I do? Like, I'm just one person. How can I even impact the world or make that difference? And for us, what the I Matter You campaign does is just go out and do something. Like, for example, my brother, you know, once a week he goes and he reads to younger kids, you know, in elementary school. Or you can plant a tree. It's as easy as picking up a piece of trash or smiling at somebody and, you know, making their day. You never know what your actions are going to do. You know, they can have a domino effect. So for me, I want to encourage them, you know, if you have that dream, just, you know, discover, research, see what you can do. Maybe there's a solution that hasn't been tapped in yet. Maybe there's a different thing that you can do that nobody has thought of before. But that's the amazing thing about, you know, young kids, is that they're so creative and they're so innovative and they come up with such amazing ideas. So they can do anything as long as they believe in themselves and they go out and do it.
So is violence against children and young people still the thing you're most mad about?
Yes, actually. I did a lot of stuff with Malaria No More right after American Idol, and that was incredible. And I've also gone back down there with Starkey Hearing Foundation and fitted a lot of people with hearing aids down there last March, and that was amazing. But I recently, last year, found out about Child Help, which is an organization that helps keep kids from feeling like they're not safe and helps them feel protected. And they have villages where some of the worst kids that are abused, they can go and live and get an education and know that their past doesn't have to determine what their future is. I went to some of their villages, and some of the stories that I heard, I was so touched, and I was crying, and I was also angry and mad that there would be somebody who would hurt a kid. That's just something that doesn't sit well with me. Over 5 kids a day pass away from child abuse, and it's something that we all know. We just don't really talk about it because it's kind of taboo. It's very touchy. But that's something that I am involved with now. I'm speaking out about it and raising awareness for that, you know, kids to speak up if something is happening to them, and to, you know, let somebody know so they don't stay in that situation.
So let's make a deal, you know, and I will get everybody at the Huffington Post to help with your cause, Child Help, and helping against, you know, violence towards young people. And can you help us with our cause, which is helping create jobs for young people?
Yes, please.
I would love to.
Yes. That sounds like a good deal to me.
So remember, Jordan's Twitter. Would you give us your
handle again? It's just my name, Jordan Sparks, with an I, not with an A.
Yes, Jordan with an I.
Sparks. And then if you guys want to learn more about I Matter You, it's facebook.com/imadru. And you can also find that on Twitter as well. It's just /imadru. Thank you guys for listening to me. I appreciate it. Thank you.
This is just the beginning. We'll continue this conversation online. My Twitter handle is @ArianaHuff. And remember my email address, ariana@huffingtonpost.com. And just before we came out on stage, I made a prediction that Jordan's mother captured on video. And I said that I predict that Jordan's destiny in terms of making a difference in the world is going to be infinitely more significant than winning the American Idol.
Thank you. We have to get her out here.
And now, remember, Jordan's mom, we are not leaving the stage unless you come out here. Where is she? She can't be shy. She's your mom.
Mom.
Can she possibly be shy?
You can come out here.
Here she is.
Thank you so much for that. It's okay, hold on to me. I got you. I got you. Don't worry.
Isn't she fabulous?
Let me go back here.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, we'll put you in the middle. Oh,
thanks for coming.
tell us something about Jordan when she was little.
Oh, shoot.
And she was naughty.
Naughty.
Or anything.
Jordan was very precocious. She got into everything. She was, you know, I'd see her on top of the kitchen cabinets. She was always singing. She knew full-blown songs by the time she was 18 months old. She was potty trained really early. I knew she was going to be a star.
How old was she when she had her first boyfriend?
First boyfriend.
Wait, what? What is happening?
First boyfriend. Well, she had her first crush, I think, in probably sixth or seventh grade. But first boyfriend didn't come until way later. What, 18?
18, yeah.
Yeah, 18. So, yeah. Thank you, guys. Go out there and make a difference. Bye.
It's okay. You're good. You're good.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome John Bridgeland and Melody Barnes, the former directors of the White House Domestic Policy Council under Presidents George W. Bush and Barack Obama.
Good afternoon. So I have to confess, Mel and my first reaction backstage was, we have to follow Jordan Sparks?
But what you don't know is that we are going to be featured on this season's American Idol. And then there's John's new movie coming out.
Right. So I know it's a bit of a downer, but I just want to say that I have to acknowledge that. Opportunity Nation truly has been a blessing in that it's been given an opportunity to work across party, across administration. For 2 years, we reached out and listened to voices all across America, including those in the Heritage Foundation, those Center for American Progress, Brookings Institution, but most importantly, and thanks to Dorothy Stoneman, who of course is in the first row, working on the front lines for 30 years. I think the most compelling thing that I've experienced through Opportunity Nation is just listening to the voices of young people. And, you know, when I see your plan that emerged that talked about, you know, we function in policy circles, and the first principle is, you know, love, empathy, forgiveness, responsibility, just so much to teach the nation and our policymakers. So hats off for your fantastic set of recommendations. But I also just wanted to mention that, you know, these issues require political leadership. We've seen the power of presidential leadership on these issues. And across two administrations, when I was with President Bush, we actually had the White House Task Force on Disadvantaged Youth and discovered that, remarkably, there were 339 federal programs spending $225 billion every year to help disadvantaged youth in the country. So there are resources, there are programs. How do we more effectively and efficiently mobilize them? And then I had the thrill, Melody and the President organized this White House Council for Community Solutions, and I got this call one day and was asked to serve on it, a Republican. And they used to kid, you know, Bridge, you don't get to come to the fancy parties, but you know, we're excited to have you work with us. And through that, that council, thanks to John Bon Jovi, and a number of the members who could reach millions of young people, we just spent most of our early time listening to the voices of young people. And what we heard was that, you know, the vast majority of them had large dreams, They saw the power of education and career to their life hopes and raising families. But interestingly, 70%, it wasn't just about them and their own life prospects, 70% of them wanted to give back to their communities and serve others. And yet only 3% reported that they were doing so because of the barriers they were facing. To me, that was one of the more exciting parts of the White House Council for Community Solutions work. And the council came forward not only with plans of action, but this wonderful focus on community collaboration. And beyond our service in the White House, and particularly Melody, with her ongoing work, is doing so much to foster the relationship between community collaboration and opportunity youth. So Mel, over to you.
Thanks, Bridge. Well, as Bridge has said, this work has been bipartisan year after year after year. And just as he worked on it in the Bush White House, I was proud to serve President Obama for 3 years and to help establish the White House Council for Community Solutions that John so ably served on. And I can tell you that we created that council because President Obama cares very, very deeply about these issues and is shocked and saddened and determined to fix the fact that we've got this opportunity gap. The fact that only 4% of young people born to parents at the bottom rungs of the opportunity ladder are able to make it to the top, believing that we have to do something about it, and as a nation, in a bipartisan fashion, have to be committed to that. And for those reasons, both John and I, coming from different administrations, have committed and dedicated ourselves to working on these issues even after both leaving the White House. And the thing that I'm doing right now, I serve as the chair of the Aspen Forum for Community Solutions, is to build on that work that John and members of the White House Council started and to create an institution that exists outside of government, but that can prod government, that can support communities, and to make sure that opportunity youth have the partners and have the resources and the solutions that they need. So in addition to focusing on community-based collaborations, which we believe are the smartest strategies to getting things done most effectively, we specifically are creating an Opportunity Youth Incentive Fund. And that fund is going to focus on putting $1 million in up to 14 different communities around the country, supporting cross-sector collaboratives, the business sector, philanthropic sector, grassroots leaders, nonprofit leaders, local and appointed elected leaders, all the way up to the federal government, working together and doing so informed by youth voices, because I heard at that summit today the importance and the strength of youth voices to support those communities working together to make sure that we create pathways to a post-secondary credential, and that at the end of attaining that credential, that young people are able to get jobs that support, help them support themselves and support their families and remain connected to the community. We know how important that is. We're here to support you. We're here to work with you and to do that with Opportunity Nation. But as I said, this takes everyone. It's just not the government. It's not just the private sector, everyone. And I know, Bridge, you've been focusing on some of the work that the private sector can do as well.
Yes, I'd just like to mention, too, that, 47% isn't some monolithic stereotype group in America. It's 100% Americans, and we all ought to all be supporting one another. And many of us, all of us, whether you're a veteran or a student who's gotten a college loan, or my parents who are on Social Security and Medicare, and we're all Americans, and we all need to support one another. That's why I'm so excited, having worked with many in this room. We've developed a national roadmap of action to concretely look at what can the private sector do, the nonprofit sector, and as importantly, the federal government across all these programs to strengthen the supports for the 6.7 million opportunity youth in the United States. We also, because some policymakers might not listen to the moral case, it's so great to hear on a bipartisan basis the members of Congress here today who are listening and are leaders and advocates for it. But marshaled the evidence that shows that the cost of inaction is $93 billion to taxpayers annually. And that case is waking up, I think, a lot of policymakers to the fact that this is an issue we have to take on. We're also, I think, one area, we had this great breakout session on career and technical education, and truly believe that these enterprise pathways, that maybe the United States has missed the boat a little bit on career and technical education. And when we did a survey of high school dropouts all across the country, I'll never forget this young girl in Philadelphia who was 16 years old, and she said, we said, what do you want to be in life? And she said, I wanted to be an astrophysicist. And we said, I'm sorry, a what? And she goes, an astrophysicist, inspired by the NASA space program. And then we asked her later on, Jeff Guerin, who's with our summit today, asked her, so what are you doing now? And she literally was working the streets of Philadelphia. And you wonder how somebody's journey takes that kind of turn. And she said that she wanted to see a connection between what she was learning in school and what she wanted to be in life. And so also today, Opportunity Nation is launching Enterprising Pathways, a national plan of action and conversation around re-envisioning, reimagining career and technical education in the United States, which we think will help address the high school dropout epidemic, so students see why they're there, and connecting learning to careers, reduce the costs of college. These 18 and 19-year-olds in Michigan who are literally getting a high school diploma and a post-secondary credential with value in the labor market, again, by the age of 19. And third, we'll reduce costs to employers that they bear when they don't get a skilled workforce. So we think these enterprising pathways can help change that conversation and debate. Mel?
Well, often people look at the challenge ahead of us and they say, oh, it's too hard, it's too tough. We can't do anything, we can't make a difference. But what we know, and what we know everyone in this room knows, it's the reason why you're here, is that we can make a difference. We can do what it takes to actually change our communities, help support the futures of young people, and to make sure that our country is strong and thriving and growing. And we don't have to wait to get started. Everyone knows that this is a big year, and we are preparing to go into 2013 with new leadership all across the nation after a presidential election. And we have to be prepared and armed with a plan. And that's what Opportunity Nation is about. That's why we're here. That's why I'm doing the work that I'm doing with so many colleagues at the Aspen Institute. But we also know that we can do that in a bipartisan fashion. And that, in fact, brings us some of our strength. When we are working together, linked arm in arm, across ideological lines, across party lines, to achieve our goals, we know that we're stronger and we're better for it. But what's most important is that we can take lessons from communities all across the country. Communities aren't waiting. That's one of the things that we learned at the White House in doing this work, that there are smart solutions that exist in every community across the country, and that there are smart ways, smart strategies that are being used to actually achieve the kind of change and the goals that we want. So we can take lessons from Europe. We can take lessons from Youth Build. We can take lessons from City Year. We can take lessons from all of the great organizations that are in this room to help inform our policies, to help inform the way that we work with the business sector, to help inform the way that we talk to our elected leaders. So if we come together and we join and link arms in, through our individual organizations under the Opportunity Nation banner, we can issue a call to action in every community and all the way up the chain to the White House that has to be responsive to the fact that we can no longer live in a country where it's okay that only 4% of youth can make it to the top of the ladder just because they happen to be born to parents who are poor or working poor. That's no excuse. That's not the country we are. That's not the country we will be. That's not the American dream. So I look forward to working with all of you. I know there's so many wonderful leaders in the room who are looking forward to working with you. Bridge and I are going to continue to work together, again, across partisan lines, because we share the same vision for the future that all of you share. Because we can do it, and as I said earlier to the Opportunity Youth gathered in the room, to the Youth Council gathered here, we are powerful when we work together. So thank you so much for your being here and for your participation. Now, I know that you all have been tweeting throughout the day, sharing your views, sharing your vision, and we want you to continue to do that. We want to continue to hear from you. But right now, we're going to take one question. I think we have time, barely, get the hook out. But we have time for one question that Bridge and I would like to respond to that's come from you. So we can put that up. So how can the Opportunity Nation Coalition build political support for the shared plan? Bridge, do you want to take
it off? Sure. So I think the most powerful thing we've seen is just, again, the youth voice, the youth recommendations, the youth stories, and then their expression through Youth Build, Year Up, City Year, the whole host of organizations that do so much to reconnect and re-engage young people, not just for themselves, but also in service to the country. And so I think literally from sharing those stories in your local communities with your mayors, with your other policymakers, your senators, your members of Congress, and then mobilizing around this, you know, shared plan of action that Opportunity Nation has developed in concert with you. Another interesting, you know, framing is that only 2% of young people who graduate high school wait to have a child before a stable family and get work before the age of 21 end up in poverty, whereas 76% of those who do none of those things end up in poverty. And, you know, there's also a lot of hope spots that I think we have to highlight. As a result of this Grad Nation campaign, there are increases in high school graduation rates across 40 states in places that were thought to be chronically unfixable, literally where, you know, graduation rates have double-digit gains, and young people, often through their own leadership and will, are finding pathways to success and successful career. Mel, what would you add?
I would add to that, one of the things that I was able to do actually just before going into the White House after the last election is to serve on the president's transition team. And no matter what happens in November, there will be that transition period. We've got a plan. Let's take the plan to the transition team. These are the folks who will continue to move forward in the administration or perhaps a new administration that's coming in. This is a bipartisan, nonpartisan event, so we'll speak to both of those events possibly occurring. Take that plan to those individuals so that they can start thinking about it and putting it into the policy apparatus. Also, we've got great partners here, again, across the ideological spectrum. It's important if we're going to work with the business community, if we're going to ensure internships and mentorship opportunities for Opportunity Youth, let's talk to some of our partners like the Chamber of Commerce and others about the ways that we can do that and to support those business leaders as they want to execute on these plans. So talk to the transition team, work with our partners, help frame the message, because we know this is such a big issue. It's one that the American people care about, and it's one that we are all putting our shoulder to the wheel on.
I would also just add that I think sometimes we risk being too timid, and when you look at where the great progress has been made in the country, it's when the vision has been bold. And so I think as a start, if we scaled up in a significant fashion, Youth Build, not just because Dorothy's in the front row, but Youth Build, Year Up, City Year, if we took, you know, the promise of the Edward M. Kennedy Serve America Act, Melody having served Kennedy for 8 years, and ramp it up to 1 million people in full-time national service in the country, and we express a bold agenda that sort of becomes who Opportunity Youth are and what our country can become. That, to me, is something that, you know, we'll work hard on a bipartisan basis to achieve.
Absolutely.
It wasn't Jordan Sparks, but we did the best we could.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rob Denson, President, Des Moines Area Community College.
Opportunity Nation, Iowa accepts the challenge. We accept and make our commitment. The word Iowa means beautiful land, and it's a state of opportunity, and opportunity is beautiful. We have a rich history. Did you know that Iowa's Norman Borlaug and Henry Wallace have been credited with saving more persons in the world than any other individuals for their advances in food production? The first computer was invented at Iowa State University. The National Bar Journal, the national legal magazine for African American attorneys, was created in Des Moines, Iowa by Robert Morris. Arabella Mansfield was the first woman attorney in the United States, admitted to the Iowa Bar in 1869. Mary Louise Smith was the first woman to chair a national political party. Edna Griffin's court battle on discrimination against the Kratz drugstore in Des Moines in 1948 occurred 7 years before Rosa Parks refused to sit in the back of the bus. And how about Buffalo Bill Cody, John Wayne, Johnny Carson, Herbert Hoover, Glenn Miller, Donna Reed, Grant Wood, Ashton Kutcher, Meredith Wilson, Harry Reasoner, Andy Williams, all Iowans, even Frodo from The Lord of the Rings. Iowa is also first in ethanol, biodiesel, corn, soybeans, egg, pork, and presidential caucuses, and it's probably not coincidental that political caucuses follow pork. So whether it's the computer, the corn picker, the tractor, the helicopter, vending machines, the trampoline, soy ink, women's rights, the arts or sciences, many opportunities started in Iowa. And I can tell you that being number 7 on Opportunity Nation's new index is not good enough. 3 states that touch Iowa, Minnesota, Nebraska, and Wisconsin, have higher scores than Iowa. And although having 4 states in the top 7 from the Midwest is a little cool, Iowa can and will do better. Let's start with Governor Terry Branstad, the first governor in the nation to declare a month as Opportunity Month by proclamation this past January. Or the creation of the Opportunity Iowa website, a companion to Opportunity Nation, where Iowans can share their stories and make their personal commitment to do better themselves or to help someone else. Or the partnerships we formed with United Way of Central Iowa, Iowa Jobs for American Graduates, Community Foundation of Greater Des Moines, Character Counts of Iowa, Boys and Girls Club of Central Iowa, AARP, and Des Moines Area Community College. Our commitment is to study the Opportunity Index and align it to Iowa data, to engage Iowa employers now looking to fill thousands of currently open, very good middle-skill jobs. We're going to fill that still skill gap. To help opportunity seekers set their pathway to opportunity and then get there. To register mentors on the Opportunity Iowa website, and to engage state leaders to speak out on opportunity and improvement and advancement. Or DMAC students who even machined the first Opportunity Nation National Medallion, having been awarded to a number of congressmen, the United States Secretary of Education, the United States Secretary of Agriculture, and other dignitaries commemorating opportunity and what skilled students can do. And the home of the only Opportunity Nation Advancing the American Dream 18-wheeler. Now appearing in parades near you if you're in Iowa. So when it comes to opportunity, is Iowa the best thing since sliced bread? I'm glad you asked. Yes, the bread slicer was also invented in Iowa. Meet Otto Roweeder. Iowa is beautiful, and it's my honor to introduce Iowa's continuing next best thing, United States Senator Tom Harkin. Senator Tom Harkin has represented Iowa in Congress for over 36 years. In Congress, he has championed education and training issues, and we call that opportunity in Iowa, and has made it a priority to support programs that allow children to start school ready to succeed. As chairman of the Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, HELP, and the Appropriations Subcommittee that funds health, education, and labor, he is uniquely positioned to both authorize and appropriate to make good things happen for America. Senator Harkin knows that learning starts at birth, and preparation for learning starts before birth. He has secured funding to establish and improve early education programs and made early education an important component of the Elementary and Secondary School Act. He believed that America's youth deserve high-quality opportunities to succeed in and outside of the classroom. Also, he wants to improve and develop outcomes for students in our country's most distressed urban and rural neighborhoods, such as through the Promise Neighborhoods Initiative. Senator Harkin believes all Americans should have access to affordable and quality post-secondary skills and education. He continues to support critical programs such as Pell, Workforce Investment Act, Perkins, and anything that provides postgraduate opportunities for all. Senator Harkin was born in Cumming, Iowa on November 19, 1939, the son of an Iowa coal miner and a Slovenian immigrant and he still lives in that same house in Cumming. One more thing. Senator Harkin authored the ADA, Americans with Disability Act, in 1990. He worked with Senator Bob Dole in a bipartisan manner and signed into law by President George H.W. Bush, the first major civil rights bill since the 1960s. Please welcome my friend and United States Senator, Tom Harkin.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you all. For goodness sakes, thank you. Thank you very much, Rob. Thank you very much for that very kind and generous introduction and for your presentation. I got to thinking as I was listening to that, you've listened to all these great speakers today. You've got Governor Patrick after me and others. And the one thing you're definitely going to remember is that the bread slicer was invented in Iowa. And to Mark Edwards, your Executive Director of Opportunity Nation, thank you. Well, I don't know everyone in this room personally, obviously, but let me tell you, I do feel like I'm among family. Because when I look at Opportunity Nation's mission to repair the ladder of opportunity in this country, that's the same mission that has been my driving passion for nearly four decades of my public life. Now, believe it or not, I was not born wearing a suit and tie or with the name Senator in front of my name. As Rob said, my mother was an immigrant. My dad was a coal miner, had a sixth grade education. Actually, he always told us he had an eighth grade education. But then he passed away, and I got to looking at some of the census tracts and things back in 1940. And he was listed there at our house, and he was listed in that census tract. It said he had a sixth grade education rather than an eighth grade education. I explained that later by saying, well, he was Irish and he bragged a lot. So my siblings and I were raised in extremely modest circumstances. I was six kids in a small two-bedroom house. But during my career, I've rubbed shoulders with plenty of powerful and successful people. And one of the things I have become acutely aware of is that most of those who have considerable wealth and success, they got to the top because from the earliest stage and earliest age, they had a network of caring and influential people who made sure that they were fully equipped to succeed in school, in career, and in life. But for poor people, low-income people, people who come from where I come from, those whose parents or parent were poor and didn't go to college, they don't have that network. To the contrary, too many of them live in distressed communities, and they go to schools that affluent families would never tolerate for their own children. Jonathan Kozol refers to these circumstances as savage inequalities. And I am haunted by Kozol's harsh conclusion, and I quote, "One consequence of medical and early education denial is the virtual destruction of the learning skills of many children by the time they get to secondary schools. That's why I have been an outspoken champion of early childhood education." And you'll note that I don't use the word of preschool. I've tried to expunge that from my vocabulary because I don't think there is such a thing as preschool. I believe that education begins at birth, and the preparation for education begins before birth. So I always try to refer to it as early education. So reaching disadvantaged kids before they start school, I didn't say before they started their education, is a crucial intervention point with a huge return on investment. It lays the early groundwork for all of the other crucial interventions and investments, everything from Title I to reduce K through 12 achievement gaps, to services like career tech, college planning, mentoring, reconnecting youth, engaging employers. And there's one other profound truth that I have learned. For so many disadvantaged young people, growing up without a network of supports we need to strive to create that network. And by we, I mean parents, local businesses, churches, and other places of worship, civil society, and more broadly, yes, the government. Quality public schools can be great ladders or ramps of opportunity. But when we bring folks together to create safe, supportive communities, that too builds a ladder or ramp of opportunity. That's why I'm a huge proponent of the Promise Neighborhood concept. As you may know, Harlem Children's Zone pioneered this model on a single city block in the 1990s and has since expanded it to 97 city blocks. The idea is to bring together educators, local leaders and employers, nonprofits, government agencies, to provide a full array of supports that children in our poorest neighborhoods need to succeed, from infancy to college or to career entry. This includes strengthening the civic fiber of these neighborhoods, from promoting affordable housing to offering adult education and legal aid. As the chair of the Appropriations Subcommittee for Labor, Health, and Human Services and Education, I have already boosted Promise Neighborhoods by providing increased funding. In addition, I have introduced the Promise Neighborhoods Act in the Senate to create federal grants to promote this model, and I secured inclusion of Promise Neighborhoods in the Elementary and Secondary Education Act reauthorization that passed out of our committee last fall. Finally, this afternoon, let me point out that a real opportunity nation must fully include young people with disabilities in school, work, and civil life. Again, a goal that has been a top priority throughout my career, as Rob Denson said, starting with the Americans with Disabilities Act. Right now, we're selling young people short who have disabilities. Of young people ages 20 to 24, the unemployment rate, and I'm not counting those in school, unemployment rate is over 60%. That's unconscionable. Shocking numbers. And no matter how many times I tell them, it still is shocking. Fortunately, today's young people with disabilities often call themselves and are called the ADA generation. They have high expectations for themselves, expectations that include work alongside their peers without disabilities. Because you see, these young people have grown up in an America reshaped by the Americans with Disabilities Act. For them, disability does not carry the fears, the myths, the stereotypes that lowered expectations for individuals with disabilities in earlier generations. So again, you have a whole group of young people out there that are not willing to take some job at sub-minimum wage. That's a dead-end kind of a thing. They want to be challenged. They want to be fully integrated with their peers in competitive employment, not some kind of employment that doesn't challenge their abilities. It's time. It's time. It's time to quit looking at young people with disabilities and seeing what they can't do. We've got to start looking at them and asking, what can you do? What are your abilities? Okay, you can't walk, what else can you do? You can't hear, what else can you do? You can't see, what else can you do? We've got to build on the abilities that every person with a disability has in our society. As the chair of the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, I'm working on a bipartisan reauthorization of the Workforce Investment Act, which authorizes a lot of our job training programs. One of the aims of that bill is to ensure that young people with disabilities and the various government programs that assist them, that integrated employment is the default position, not sheltered workshops or other segregated environments. And that's why I would offer to you, I would hope that the Opportunity Index, by the way, I'm very proud. I just heard that Iowa went from 13 to 7. We're on our way. I'm very proud of that. But I hope that the Opportunity Index that Opportunity Nation uses will also include in there the people with disabilities, young people with disabilities, and what opportunities are afforded them, both in education, job training, and employment in the various counties and states around the nation. I hope that will be a part of your index. So my friends, as I talk about early childhood education and promised neighborhoods and opportunities for youth with disabilities, I know that I'm preaching to the choir, but in fact, of the more than 250 groups that make up Opportunity Nation, you're pretty much like the Mormon Tabernacle Choir when it comes to providing a ladder of opportunity for all of our young people. So I can't thank you enough for the work that you are doing day in and day out all across America. You give a hand up to people who truly need it and deserve it, young people growing up in poverty or with some other disadvantage. You give them boots so they can pull themselves up by their bootstraps. You give them a ladder, or in the case of many people with disabilities, a ramp of opportunity. I always talk about a ladder of opportunity, but prior to the Americans with Disabilities Act, millions of Americans, no matter how hard they tried, couldn't climb that ladder because they were disabled. So what we did is we passed the Civil Rights Bill and we built a ramp of opportunity, a ramp. See, there's not one nickel, not one dime goes to any person with a disability in the Americans with Disabilities Act. What we did is we said we're going to break down the barriers, we're going to fully integrate people with disabilities in all aspects of our life, and then we're going to challenge people with disabilities, go for it. But we're going to provide you the opportunity. So you do. You give them a ladder, a ramp of opportunity. You give them hope. In fact, the work you do is just about the most important work that I can imagine. So I'm proud to consider myself, hopefully, a citizen of Opportunity Nation. I am proud to be your partner and champion on Capitol Hill. And from the bottom of my heart, I thank you all for your great work and the passion that you bring to it. Thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Deval L. Patrick, Governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Opportunity Nation. Thank you, and thank you, Mark Edwards, for the important work you are doing and for including me in today's conversation. I'm honored to be with you. We hear a lot during election seasons about American exceptionalism. To me, what's exceptional is that we are the only nation in human history not organized the way nations are normally organized. We're not organized around a common language or religion or even culture. We're organized around a handful of civic ideals. And we've identified these ideals over time and through struggle as equality, opportunity, and fair play. For this, more than anything else, I submit, we are the envy of the world. Opportunity is central to the American dream. That notion that in this country you can imagine a better future for yourself and your family and then reach for it. It's the dream of pilgrims who came to the American wilderness in search of religious freedom, of immigrants who fled oppression in search of a chance to prosper and still do today, of your parents and grandparents who scraped and saved so you wouldn't have to struggle as hard as they did. It's my story too. I grew up on the south side of Chicago in the 50s and the 60s, most of that time on welfare. Who's here from Chicago? I lived with my mother and my sister and various other relatives who came and went in our grandparents' two-bedroom tenement. My mother, sister, and I shared one of those bedrooms and a set of bunk beds. So you'd go from the top bunk to the bottom bunk to the floor every third night on the floor. I went to big, broken, overcrowded, under-resourced, sometimes violent public schools. My guess is that the opportunity index for that neighborhood in those days was not that good. There were a lot of things we didn't have, but one thing we did have was a real sense of community. Because those were days when every child was under the jurisdiction of every single adult on the block. So if you messed up down the street, if you messed up down the street in front of Ms. Jones's, she'd go right upside your head as if you were hers, and then call home, right? So you got it two times. There was a lot of emphasis on individual responsibility and hard work, but those adults also wanted us to understand that a community is about seeing your stake in your neighbor's dreams and struggles, as well as your own. I was influenced by my grandfather's work ethic, my mother's determination to get her GED, get off welfare, and get a job, my grandmother's faith. I felt the high expectations of the old ladies in church and the teachers in our segregated schools. And though no one in my family had ever been to college when I graduated from Harvard College in 1978, I know how lucky I was to be in a family where no one ever told me I couldn't. All of that was vital for me then, just as it is for children from such neighborhoods today. But it was not enough. When my family was broke, food stamps helped us eat. When my sister needed her teeth fixed, a subsidized dental program provided it. There were well-prepared, dedicated, fully engaged teachers, even in our dilapidated public school, who helped us imagine what it might be like to become a citizen of the world. Individuals are responsible for the hard work, discipline, sacrifice, and mental and physical toughness necessary to excel. But a community helped me emerge from the South Side of Chicago to law school, to the executive ranks in Fortune 500 companies, and to the Massachusetts State House today. And sometimes that community is called government. Now, I don't think that government can or should undertake to solve every problem in everybody's life, but it does have a role to play in helping people help themselves. And I submit that we will never let opportunity flourish, especially for poor and marginalized children, until we stop trivializing the role of government and start focusing on what government can and must do well. Government, after all, is just the name we give to the things we choose to do together. This is actually not a new idea in America. Americans rarely leave anything that we believe is really important entirely to chance. When we decided that settling the West was important, we created land-grant programs and built the Transcontinental Railroad. When we decided that educating our children was important, we developed public schools and universities. When we decided that liberty for all was important, I mean really important, we freed the slaves, gave women the right to vote, and sometimes even went to war. We tend to shape our own future in this country, not just let it happen to us. And in each case, government helped create opportunity. We built the greatest middle class in the history of the world in the second half of the 20th century, with hard work and ingenuity, yes, but also with the GI Bill and the interstate highway system. A generation of Americans have lifted themselves out of poverty with the help of Pell Grants and government institutions like the University of Michigan and Florida A&M or Roxbury Community College. My point is that a lot of current political rhetoric about government is self-defeating. It's hard to create more opportunity when many want to fundamentally undermine the tools that have successfully created opportunity in this country for centuries. In Massachusetts, like everywhere else, we were hit hard by the global economic collapse. In state government, we cut programs and thousands of jobs. But even when the bottom was falling out of the rest of the state budget, we funded the schools at the highest level in the history of our Commonwealth. We doubled the investment in infrastructure. We expanded our investment in innovation and in research. And by the way, the Obama administration helped with every single one of those. And because of those investments, we are growing nearly twice as fast as the national growth rate. Our innovation economy is on fire, and we are first in the nation in student achievement. Why do this? Why do this during a recession? Because if you really believe in creating opportunity, you can't tell a second grader she has to sit out the second grade until the recession is over. You don't tell someone with a great idea for a new transformative company that those jobs can wait until the amorphous market feels like hiring again. It's silly to believe that government can do it all, but it's equally silly to limit the contribution government can make and has always made in building a stronger national, or in our case, statewide community. At the Democratic National Convention earlier this month, I told a story about the Orchard Gardens Elementary School in Boston. Thanks to an infusion of new ideas and tools and a little new money, this once chronically underperforming school is in the midst of a profound transformation. In less than a year, proficiency measures at Orchard Gardens improved 70%. Less than a year. The school has gone from one of the worst schools in the district to one of the best in our state. At the end of my visit a year and a half ago, the first grade, led by a veteran, wonderful, loving teacher, gathered to recite for me. First, they presented a poem to multicultural tolerance, and I started to applaud, and the teacher said, "Not yet, Governor." And then they proceeded to recite most of the "I Have a Dream" speech, Dr. King's incredible paean to justice. And I started to applaud again, and the teacher said, "Not yet, Governor." And then she started to ask those 6 and 7-year-olds questions. She asked them, "What does creed mean? What does nullification mean? Where is Stone Mountain?" And as the hands shot up to answer her questions, I realized she had taught the children not just to memorize, but to comprehend what they had recited. There are some nowadays who tell us that those first graders are all on their own to deal with their poverty, with ill-prepared young parents, maybe who speak English as a second language, with an under-resourced and all-around depressed public school, with neighborhood crime and hopelessness, with no access to nutritious food and no place for their mom to cash a paycheck, with a job market that needs skills they don't have, with no way to pay for college. But those Orchard Gardens kids should not be left on their own. If we are to be a national community with common cause and common destiny, then we must see those children as our children too, yours and mine. And among them are the future scientists, entrepreneurs, teachers, artists, laborers, engineers, and civic leaders we desperately need. For this country to rise, they must rise. And we have a common stake in that. We have a common stake in their equality, so we make the schools work better for all children. We have a common stake in their opportunity, so we make ways for them to get the training and higher education they need to participate in and to shape the innovation economy of tomorrow. We have a common stake in assuring that the systems by which they are measured and held accountable are fair, that the playing field itself is level. We work for good government because good government makes these things possible. We do it because faith in the American dream still defines what it means to be America. The part I left out of the Orchard Garden story when I told it at the convention is this. This past February, 20 first graders from Orchard Gardens arrived in Washington on what was, for most of them, I think, their first flight on an airplane. They went to practice reciting the I Have a Dream speech one more time, this time in front of that glorious new monument to Dr. King on the National Mall. Later that afternoon, they, along with that loving teacher and their bashful principal, went to the White House to recite for the President of the United States. Watching them run around the South Lawn, burning off nervous energy while they waited, or gawking at the unfamiliar splendor of the interiors, or asking where the bathroom is, or staring in bug-eyed disbelief when President Obama entered the diplomatic reception room. They could have been any 6 or 7 year olds. And yet I'm certain that they felt important that day simply because someone made them feel worthy. Worthy. It was extraordinary that that someone was the President of the United States. But what matters most is that someone made them feel worthy. Someone. They could have been any 6 or 7 year old, yes. They should be every 6 or 7 year old. The American dream belongs to them as much as to you and me. It's worth fighting for. It's worth investing in. It's worth sharing responsibility for, because it is still central to who we are. Thank you for your work. Let's get this done. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Chris Coons, United States Senator from Delaware.
Is there someone from Delaware in the House? It was so great to be with you at Delaware State University back in March for the Inspired Day of Service, and I'm so honored to join you here today as Opportunity Nation gathers to chart a course for our path forward. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, a conviction in things unseen. To some of you, this is familiar. To some, it's new. It's from the ancient scriptures. It's from Hebrews. And it's a reminder that those things that pull us forward are things that are often intangible. As Governor Patrick just talked about, the American dream is something that is at real risk of falling away. The American dream for the young boys and girls he talked about at Orchard Gardens is something that is at risk of turning into either a dream that vanishes in morning light or a nightmare that traps them into a world where opportunity is for other people. And the American dream has left them at their bedside. I wanted to talk with you for a few minutes today, if I could, about my own experience at a middle school in Wilmington's East Side, a school called Bancroft, a school where an incredibly engaged and caring and motivated principal and a terrific community-based nonprofit worked together to make possible opportunity in a nonprofit I helped found and that found its way in some small part into the shared plan today. But let me first just start by thanking you. The 250 organizations that make up Opportunity Nation touch 100 million Americans. And that's tremendous reach and a great opportunity at a time when the national conventions and the election season seems to be more of a Punch and Judy show of exchanging one-liners than a serious focus on building the future for the young Americans who most deserve our attention. I'm grateful that Opportunity Nation is there, is here, with a plan, with a clear vision for how to make this future possible. You've already heard today from two great leaders from the United States Senate. Senator Harkin, can we have a round of applause for Senator Tom Harkin, the chairman of the Health, Education, Labor Committee. You could hear in his comments today his passion for children of all backgrounds, but in particular, his persistent, his patient, his lifelong engagement on behalf of the disabled. And I know earlier today you heard from Senator Marco Rubio of Florida, who has joined me as a co-sponsor in the bill I hope to talk about. Yes, a round of applause, if you would, for Senator Rubio. You know, I think it's important for us to show our young people that though we might be Republican or Democrat from the heartland of Iowa or from the deep southern state of Florida, whatever our background, whatever our political calling, opportunity for young Americans is still something we feel deeply about. Something for which we're passionate, something for which we're willing to cross a partisan divide. As the son and grandson of classroom teachers myself, as someone who has seen the transformative power of education and experienced it in my family and in my community, I was excited to be able to introduce in the United States Senate an idea that was built out of a personal passion. I can also talk about it in the abstract terms that if we want to be a successful and competitive economy, if we want to continue to grow our nation and we want to continue to fix our deficit, and if we want to compete on a global scale, we have to have a country where your future isn't determined by your zip code, where income inequality isn't marred by complete lack of social mobility. But that's the up here stuff. The in here stuff for me came from Bancroft Middle School. Long before I entered elected service, when I was a much younger man, I helped start a nonprofit in Delaware called the I Have a Dream Foundation. And what I saw in more than a dozen years of active work with 50 young people from the East Side, from Bancroft Middle School, changed these abstract statistics into faces, into names, into families, into paths. Instead of thinking about the tragedy that America used to have, the number one, we were number one in the world in college graduates, and today we're number one in college dropouts. We're number one in kids who start college but leave with crushing debt. Those are abstract statistics. Instead of thinking about the important but also abstract statistic about only 1 in 10 young people of the background that was typical in Bancroft Middle School having any hope of college, and instead focusing on the constellation of young people who actually finished college through our work together, they moved in my heart, in my family, in my life, from abstract numbers to real people. Kizzy and Taran, Zelly, Ian, and David, 50 young people whose lives are intensely interwoven into my own and whose stories haunt me and challenge me and inspire me, even to this day. The bill that I introduced is called the American Dream Accounts, and it's at the core of an idea that's here in the shared plan. An idea that, to put it in the abstract, in policy speak, says we need to initiate college planning support for low-income students paired with asset development. That didn't get a round of applause because it's a little obscure. So let me take a minute, if I can, and put some meat on those bones. What does initiate college planning support for low-income students paired with asset development mean? It means having faith in the assurance of things hoped for, a conviction of things unseen. Every young person at Bancroft Elementary who stays the course, works their way through school, and is interested in college is eligible for something called a Pell Grant. They've never met Senator Pell. They don't know who he is. They aren't even aware of this existence. In the state of Delaware, we have seed grants and discover grants that make it possible to go to Delaware Technical and Community College, Delaware State University, University of Delaware. Yet young people at 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 have never heard of these things. They're abstract. They're out in the ether somewhere. The idea here, first, is to make them real. Studies show that any young person who knows from an early age that there is an individual college savings account in their name is 7 times more likely to go to college. For folks who've known this from childhood, this is common sense. For folks who haven't experienced this, it's hard to understand that when you grow up in a classroom, a community, a family, an environment where you being able to afford college doesn't begin being mentioned or discussed until you're in high school, it's just often too late. So one of the great insights of the I Have a Dream program was to break into that and to make a credible personal promise of a college tuition scholarship, not in 7th grade, not in 10th grade, not when you're applying for college as a senior, but early in elementary school. Why? To change the game, to change the trajectory, to lift the eyes and to hold up a mirror to young people from their earliest ages that says, this is who you can be, this is who you will be. You dream of. Have you ever stood before a group of kids in an elementary school and asked, what's your dream? What do you hope to be? You get the same answers, regardless of the zip code or the background, the income level or the type of school you're standing in front of. Young people in elementary school shout out the same things, regardless of where they're from. They don't dream of dramatically different outcomes. They dream of the same things. And college, higher education, finishing high school is an essential part for all of them, except professional basketball star. As someone who never dreamed of being a professional basketball star, for painfully obvious reasons, I think I could connect with young people who needed that extra faith and that extra encouragement from the very beginning. So that's one element of the American Dream Accounts bill that I've introduced and Senator Rubio has co-sponsored, and that's at the core of this asset development plan referred to in the shared plan. What's next? Now you understand. The reality is every state in the United States has an existing program, flexible, individualized, secure college savings accounts, 529 plans, but very, very few of the working class families, of the people who are most in need of this help, are aware of them or use them. And in states like Delaware that have not just Pell grants available, but state grants available, that really make a Dell Tech education, a Dell State education entirely accessible, we don't tell young people until it's too late. So first, imagine that you in elementary school hear about this year in and year out. Second, one of the biggest challenges we faced with our 50 young people was movement. They moved all the time. They all started at Bancroft, but they ended up at 14 different high schools. And the path they took from elementary school to middle school to high school was very unpredictable. And so many of them lost the progress they'd made as they moved from school to school, where teachers who were trying their hardest and working their heart out had classrooms of 25 or 30 students. And in the middle of the year, they'd get a new student in the back. And what information would they get? They wouldn't know this new student. Just because Turan showed up in the middle of the school year from another school didn't mean he came with this whole full folder that helped the teacher connect with and understand this new student. And that was one of our biggest contributions, was going and visiting the new school, connecting the parents to the new school, connecting the student to the new school, connecting the mentor who'd been with him at Bancroft to Gauger, their new school. But that's so labor-intensive and so demanding and difficult that when we've met with folks over the years, people from I Have a Dream Foundation, we've heard over and over from the U.S. Department of Education to the Ford Foundation, that's just too expensive. How could you scale that to touch whole schools or whole districts or the millions of young people who drop out who we need to touch? Well, one thing has changed profoundly since my years working the east side of Wilmington and then nationally with I Have a Dream across the country as our dozens of classes around the country played out. That's these things. Individualized student college savings accounts that match up with an individualized dream book that says, what did you dream of doing? How did you do in your class? Who were your teachers? Is possible. Imagine a Facebook for college and for life. States like Delaware have already invested in these systems. There is a complete career and college awareness computerized system in Delaware, individually tracked, secure, and private, yet it doesn't connect in any way to the college savings plan. It doesn't connect in any way to your experience in the classroom, to teachers' reflections, to mentoring, and to parents. These are all in silos. And on top of that, once a young person drops out, should they drop out of high school, we then spend billions more in federal dollars on a completely separate job training program. So if you're in Job Corps after several years off from high school, it's as if you've never been in school before, even though the school you dropped out of might be four blocks away. These silos in the American publicly funded education, training, and college access system need to be broken down. And so what I bring to you to share today is just a simple and powerful idea. One that's been tried, one that's been demonstrated. You might want to look, for example, at how the whole city of Syracuse, in partnership with a foundation called Say Yes to Education, has made a community pledge to its young people of college access, of mentoring and tutoring support, of high school completion, and of follow-through support into higher education. You might want to look at a bill that Chaka Fatah in the House from Philadelphia and I have co-sponsored that helps encourage these sorts of wraparound community college support foundations. You might want to look at the Harlem Children's Zone and what an impact that's been able to make on high school completion and on college attendance. There are a dozen more times and places where folks have taken a stab at these ideas. And Secretary Arne Duncan, the United States Secretary of Education, who himself got his start in education helping run an I Have a Dream program on the south side of Chicago, has put into this year's Gear Up program a $9 million demonstration project for individualized college savings accounts that will touch 10,000 young people and help them lift their sights towards the possibility of college. Let me just say, if I can, in conclusion, that these ideas need your help to make them more specific, to make them more powerful, to make them have lift, to make them have life. In the end, what I hope comes out of this American Dream Accounts Act is a federally funded demonstration program, a platform, a way to facilitate connecting across all these different silos from early childhood to middle and elementary school to high school to college awareness to career awareness to college savings to college completion. But that's the up here about it. In the end, as you know more than anything else, the in here about it is to change the sad, the grinding, the difficult reality today of an enormous achievement gap in our country, of painful statistics that suggest that whether you're likely to go to college or finish college can be predicted by the zip code in which you live. That should not be our country going forward. And with your hope, your faith, and your investment of time and energy and belief in this shared plan and in the values that it embodies, we can and should be able to make bold ideas like this possible and to be able to change the future for millions of young Americans. From one where they can simply dream of going to a great college, something they see on TV or hear about from distant relatives or friends, to something that's a part of their life from their earliest days, something on which they can bank, something on which they can plan, something on which they can build, a life of opportunity, of engagement, of service, and of hope. Thank you for your interest, and thank you for what you're doing to make America an opportunity nation.
Ladies and gentlemen, for our closing, please welcome Russell Crumnow, Grassroots and Coalition Manager, Opportunity Nation.
We've had a great day together. Do you agree? This has been a fantastic day together at Opportunity Nation. We've come together today to discuss the challenges we face and the solutions that are out there and how we have to jumpstart the American dream, specifically getting more young adults on a pathway to success. We've heard from leaders from across the country, from all different backgrounds, all different sectors, and all parts of the ideological spectrum who agree on this goal. In particular, I know we've been inspired by the leadership and the thoughtfulness and the energy of the young people in the room today that have brought so much to today's event. We're so thankful for all of you participating in the summit today. But now, of course, the real work begins, right? Today was inspiring. It was exciting, it was hopefully fun for you to be here and connect with others, but the real work, the hard work begins tomorrow. That's why Opportunity Nation's plan culminates with a call to action, as I'm sure you've seen throughout the day with examining that document. It says to everyone, there's a role that you can play, big or small. We can all make a difference in the life of a young adult, whether we run a business, a nonprofit organization, or simply are engaged leaders and citizens in our own communities. Right now, there's a text poll that's going to be on the screen. I want you to pull out your phone one last time, and I want you to really demonstrate how you're going to join in this work. There are some examples of some elements of our call to action that are things that you can do to make a difference. So text now, demonstrating to us which part of the call to action is most exciting and relevant to you. To demonstrate the momentum coming out of today, and to show the unity that we all have together, you are now going to hear briefly from several people who are already committing to do parts of this call to action in their own work and to send that challenge out to you all to join us. Whether they lead big organizations or lead change in their own street or block or community, these are truly fantastic leaders that we're so proud are a part of Opportunity Nation. So I want you to welcome them now as we're going to hear from several outstanding folks that are going to share with you what they're doing to take this call to action forward and to make a difference. And the first person that you're going to hear from joining me now on stage is Stacy Stewart, Executive Vice President of United Way Worldwide. Stacy?
Thank you, Russell. And we at United Way Worldwide are so pleased and so excited to respond to the call to action by doing something that we think is really important. And there are lots of things that we're doing all across our national network. But one of the most critical things that we're committing to do is to respond to this call for mentoring. We know that every time there's a concerned and caring adult in the life of a young person, that young person is certainly on a path for success. And so that's why United Way Worldwide has announced a goal to recruit 1 million readers, tutors, and mentors to help young people succeed. And so we hope that this will be successful and a part of the call to action.
Thank you, Stacy.
Hi, my name is Anthony Britt, and I proudly serve as a program manager at City Air Boston. I'm really excited about this plan because as a Teach for America Corps member in the Mississippi Delta, I saw daily that overcoming the lack of opportunity and resources requires additional support beyond an effective educator in the classroom. I'm excited to lead a team of 12 young adults who are dedicated to serving in schools, making sure that students are in school and on track to graduate. I'm excited to serve and committed to this plan with Opportunity Nation and serve through City Air Boston, because we don't just wait around for things to happen and things to get better, we make better happen.
I'm Amber Cruz with Mobilize.org. Hello, everyone, out here in the audience. And I wanted to share my commitment on behalf of Mobilize.org, given our work to empower and invest in millennials to create solutions to the problems that they're facing in the community. We are mobilizing young people across the country to talk to their elected officials and to create solutions to civic engagement that they can implement on their campuses and in their communities. And so I'm proud to be a member of the coalition and to work with all of you going forward to help support this work and to continue not just for the 2012 election, but beyond 2012 to empower young people.
Hello, everyone. My name is Linda Nelson from El Dorado, Arkansas, serving Ouachita Calhoun County in Arkansas. I am extremely excited to be part of Opportunity Nation. I believe in this campaign, and I support the campaign by taking action to engage at least 100 low-income, disconnected, and at-risk youth through workshops that will provide them with the skill and also to be able to look at their chosen pathway and what it entails and what it exactly means to get to a pathway. I believe, too, that they should be able to compete in a global economy and in the 21st century. And I hope that the work that we'll do in Ouachita County for the low-income, disconnected, and at-risk youth will help. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Amy Saxton, and I'm the CEO of Summer Search, a national youth development nonprofit. I am thrilled and grateful to be a part of Opportunity Nation. We are helping empower the authentic voices of young people at Summer Search. We do that by having them serve on our alumni boards and having them serve on our governing board and actually helping to lead the organization forward. Perhaps most importantly, we work with 2,000 young people across the country, and like you heard from one of them, Chris Hill, this morning, we help them develop their authentic story and self-advocate for their own success.
Hello, everyone. My name is Christopher Prado. I'm from Stockton, California. I'm currently working as an after-school educator on my friend Michael Tubbs' city council race in the Stockton City Council. And along with that, I'm a part of the Summer Success and Leadership Academy, which is a student-run program where we help students create community action plans and opportunity youth set educational goals in my city. And I'm really excited to answer this call to action to commit to the Opportunity Nation plan and play my role in this way. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Corinne Deliberto with World Vision. And we do youth development work all around the nation. 12 different areas. And I think the biggest connection I see is definitely under empowering young voices, particularly through our youth empowerment program, which is a youth leadership and civic engagement program we have that enables high school students to develop policy recommendations, do advocacy on their own, and connect with their public officials and really speak out and represent the young people in their communities. So we definitely see a connection there and are looking forward to empowering young voices. We are also a faith-based organization, and I'm fully expecting us to engage in encouraging faith-based groups all around the nation to get engaged in the shared plan and connect. So we look forward to working with you all. Thanks.
I'm Rob Denson, president of Des Moines Area Community College, and the important thing is to get the word out. When we had the governor sign a proclamation declaring February Opportunity Month in Iowa, that same day, a beloved governor from the past issued an editorial in our statewide paper, the Des Moines Register. Tuesday before we came here, I had an editorial in the Des Moines Register talking about Opportunity Nation and opportunity. Don't wait for an event to happen. You create the event and then invite the press. Go meet with your governor. Give him an award or certificate. Invite the press to take a picture. If you have anyone in your area that is well-respected, government official, actor, whatever it may be, meet with them and have them write for your local paper. Editorial comments are extremely important, particularly when it's from someone that everyone respects. So you need to have go make it happen. You now have the tools you need. You have an agenda. So create an event and then invite the media.
Excited to have these commitments to action from these fantastic partners. And so now the question is posed to all of you. What commitment will you make? What will you do starting tomorrow to move this shared plan forward? Opportunity Nation is going to be elevating this plan and elevating some of the great solutions and work happening around the country during a week of action, October 8th through 15th. So go to our website, watch for more information about that and how you can be involved. Join the dialogue, learn your opportunity index score, take action, and make a difference. Thank you all so much for being a part of this and for committing to join us in this shared plan starting tomorrow. We can make a difference together. Thank you, Russell. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So before we go, please hold on for one moment. I think it's really important that we thank some of the people who you've not seen on this audience, because putting together an event like this does not happen by magic. There are people who've put in a ton of work here, and I think it's important that they get acknowledged. This has been an extraordinary day. On behalf of the Steering Committee of Opportunity Nation and Be the Change, I want to thank some of the people you have not seen on stage here, who really are behind the scenes pulling this whole thing together. Kara Willis, Lizzie Burns, Justin Kang, Sarah Beaulieu, Jason Gray, Chris Cashman, Chris Tuttle, Tim Papalardo, Katie Tirio, and all the interns at Opportunity Nation who made this possible. Thanks also to our host, George Washington University. Thanks to our tech team who put together this incredible spread here. Jack Morton Worldwide with Bill Cates, Peter August, Donna DeAngelis, and Peter Ryan. Thanks also to our pro bono legal counsel, Aiken Gump, who's been incredible. Our communications partners, Ogilvy PR Worldwide. Our strategic advisor, John Bridgeland. And our in-kind partners, IBM, Grossman Marketing, and Shop Progress. And finally, let's not forget the investors who make all this possible. Our 2012 Summit corporate sponsor, Bank of America, the Annie Casey Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Kresge Foundation, the Rockefeller Foundation, the Be the Change Board, and the many other champions of our work. And finally, a final shout out to some of our earliest investors who were involved long before we had any of the momentum we do today. Jonathan Levine, Josh Beckenstein, Sandy Edgerly, Dan Carroll, Maurice and Lily Samuels. Thank you all for being here. Good afternoon.